they are ready. So, without any further ado, we have James Marster.
Basically, Buffy was a coming-of-age story, and So the filter that you were watching it through changed, particularly as everybody got older. So the morality for me was so black and white in the early seasons. Good was good, bad was bad. It was easy to tell, you know. And then as she gets older, as everybody got older, it becomes far more gray, and you realize that light is a window into how much more complex life is, and the right thing to do isn't always easy, it isn't always clear. So for me, the morality changed and got much more complicated and much more gray and much more true to adult life as it went on.
Thematically, for my character, it was, you didn't need powers to be powerful. You know, the power of listening, the power of observing was just as important as the power of making fireballs coming from the bombs. I think, yeah, at the base of it is, and I think I never really thought about what we were talking about, but you're right. But in the beginning, in the beginning, it was how do you get through adolescence? You know, because in adolescence you figure out that the world is messed up, that your parents are kind of idiots, and your teachers only half understand the things that they're teaching you. And how do you realize that and then not give up in the face of it? How do you keep trying? I think that's the theme of Buffy, is don't give up. But you're right, the morality question. Thank God, because otherwise I would have been killed off immediately.
Contract herpes, tell your next partner right away that you have that disease.
Thank you, Nick. Pearls for the day.
Yeah, all right. That was an allergy medicine, by the way.
Okay. It's not a question. Well, it is. Could you do an improv for us, just like in your characters?
Wow, God, there's no way right now I can do it. I can imagine doing that right now. We're so serious. There we go.
I refuse. I don't do the accent anymore. I've moved on with my life.
Just sit here quietly and be supportive.
Somebody came up to me at my line a couple days ago, the autograph line, and she said her favorite line. I guess since I had so many great lines, and I guess Cordelia had just been kidnapped and sent the letter, and I said, they're gonna make a meal. They're gonna cook Cordelia or something. They're gonna make a meal for Cordelia. Like, oh, so she's fine, guys. They're gonna make her dinner. Like, they're gonna cook her, eat her. Like, fine. And then, like, tonight. She's good. They're gonna cook her dinner.
Hi, this question is for James. We met you one time in New Orleans, and you answered a really good question for us, and we have a follow up to that. This question, and everyone will be upset about this question, but we talked about Dragon Ball Evolution, and what I really need to know is, will they ever make a Dragon Ball Z? We know that you said you really liked playing Piccolo. Will they ever pick it up? TV, movie, it doesn't matter, will they?
I think it's possible that they'll make a Dragon Ball Z, but I do not think they'll use the producer that did Dragon Ball. I think it'll be a complete reboot, and they'll start from scratch. So I'll have to go audition again, but I would love to go. I'll give it a shot. They're not gonna. It's dead. The
movie didn't do very well.
I remember, this is a good story. I remember I took my two kids to see the movie. And my son was so excited because he grew up on Dragon Ball Z. And he was so excited he let us in. He let us into the theater. And I was just thinking, man, just please, please, my kids with me. It's opening day. Please, big audience. Please, please, please. And packed. It was a packed audience. And there were like all of these young guys in there. And you couldn't even really get three seats together. And we finally kind of got three seats close to each other. And I'm looking around. And I'm just a little voice inside my head just goes, this is too good to be true. And I turn to the dude, this 13-year-old next to me. And I'm like, hey, man, is this Dragon Ball? And he's like, what? Is this Dragon Ball, man? No! This is Fast and Furious, man! So I get my two kids up, and we walk across the hall, and we see Dragon Ball, and as we're opening the door, I'm just like, please, man, just half an audience, please, please. Half full would be fine. Just don't embarrass me in front of my kids. Universe, please. There were like two other people out there. Film did well in Asia, I think. But not too great here.
This is kind of a question for everybody, but if you've read, I wanted to ask if you've read the Buffy comic books with the continuation of the series, and if you've liked how your characters have developed in that.
I have read. I'm going to stop doing it.
No, go.
Some of it, and I think it's fabulous. You know, apparently, I was talking to David Fury about this, and apparently Joss has tried to get, he's tried to go back and like do like a Xander television movie, or do a Spike television movie, or he has wanted to come back and revisit the characters, and keep working on it, but every time he tries, the Kazooies ruin it. They are the people that produced the original film, and when Joss signed that contract, he had no power at all. So the Kazooies got a great contract, and they got the rights to all Buffy characters that come out of that universe. So they were on paper producers of the television show, although they didn't have any say in anything, but they did get paid out. But apparently, whenever Joss has tried to, I mean, they're all like producing some of the biggest shows in Hollywood, but they, whenever I talk to them, like, David Fury is like, great.
Yeah. Yeah, it's wonderful. You know, my love life situation, I think it's fine, totally fine with the Don Zander relationship.
You what?
Yeah.
You dog.
Yeah, we've been
seeing. Always be 12 to you.
No, well, I saw her in she did a spread in, I think, gym. She's not 12 anymore. Yeah, we've been scissoring for a while.
I'm sorry, man, but she's 40 years old, I will think of her as.
Not unless she was in front of me.
All right.
Then you'd be like, you're not 12 anymore, right?
All right.
But I'm her mother.
I've had my eye on you for a long time. Anyone have anything to say?
Hi, my question is about fan fiction, particularly for you, James. Oh, God. First of all, have you read any?
What? I think it's awesome that it's written, though. I mean, we, you know, as storytellers, whenever you do any art, you're trying to get the audience involved. You're trying to elicit a reaction, and that the audience would create their own art using those situations and those characters is just fabulous. It's just so pretty.
So is that uncomfortable for you knowing that people are taking Spike out and creating their own little Spike pops, or is it flattering?
I don't really, it's not really flattering or uncomfortable. I think it's awesome, just on an artistic level. It's great that people are creating, you know, their own stuff. I think that, you know, art is a human birthright. It's one of the things that makes being human worth it, along with good food. Being a human, like a dog, it's like, hi, I'm happy again. You know, when I wake up, I'm like, not happy again. So being able to create stuff, like, I paint, right? I suck at it. But hey, I'm like, I'm a human being, I'm gonna pick something. It's, you know, I don't have to try to sell it. I'm just gonna paint. And so
how much do you want for it? What do you want? I'll pay anything. How much do you want for it?
But you know, it's my human birthright to go and create that. So I think it's fabulous. It's just if I read it, then I get embarrassed. Then it's just like.
Hi. So one of the things that's been really getting me through the past couple of months is constantly saying, what would Buffy do? And I had to leave my apartment complex due to a huge cockroach infestation. So I thought, instead of what would Buffy do, what would Xander do? What would Joyce do? What would Spike do? How would you handle a cockroach infestation?
I know you asked them, but I probably have a lot more experience with cockroaches than anybody in this room, because I lived in New York. You come in at like 3 o'clock in the morning, you flip on the lights, and then you just go, and you kill them with your bare hands, because they're too fast to like get nice about it. You can also take steel wool and a really thin flathead screwdriver, and you jam it into every single crack or crevice, and you can sometimes buy this illegal Chinese powder. And you draw a perimeter around the edge of the room, and if the cockroaches cross it, they die. And I know it's true because I've watched it happen.
When I lived in Astoria, Queens, I went to step on a big cockroach. I swear to God, it was this big, and it screamed at me. California kid, you know.
Oh, but water bugs are a whole other story.
I tried to get this thing going on my Twitter. I think you're coming at this at the wrong angle. I think you need to ask yourself, what wouldn't Gwyneth Paltrow do?
I can't keep up. I can't follow you.
I speak in mixed metaphors.
Question is has to do with how much time has passed since Buffy ended, and you guys have continued to do these cons and panels, and the fan base is huge. I just wanted to know from each of you what your strangest fan encounter has been at one of these places, because we all know we're kind of drunk and crazy.
But that was a long time ago. In general, no. I mean, I have to say, anybody that likes Buffy the Vampire Slayer, they have a sense of humor. You know, it's kind of a line in the sand. And if you don't have a sense of irony, or if you take yourself or the world too seriously, you never watch the show to begin with. And so generally, I find that fan interaction is like, you guys are smart, you're funny, you're cool. I have a really good time. The weirdest thing that happened is when I went to London, and it was very early on. I think I'd only been on the show for half a year, And I went to London, and I was at a convention, and we were all hanging out, and this old lady came up and says, my friend has a favor to ask you. And I was like, yeah, sure, man. And the friend was like, you know, even older. And she's like, turn around. And I was like, cool. And I hear a little voice, bend over. And I'm such an idiot. I did it. And then she grabbed my ass. Just boom. And then I hear this word, now clench. And I just ran. I just ran. It's like the cocktail party was over. And I was like, I'm back in my room now. And I was just sitting on the bed, shaking. Like, I don't believe this is happening to me anymore. So now I'm careful. Because every once in a while, other people do weird things. But in general, that's really by far the weirdest thing. Nothing even close to that has happened. But I also probably, maybe I'm better at setting boundaries.
I've been good. I think it's maybe my character. Theo Zander was more of the everyday guy, you know. But I was talking to old friends last night about, you said, you know, the fans have a sense of irony, which makes them. So Alanis Morissette song isn't ironic. Of course, we all know that nothing in that song is ironic. But this is where the mind went yesterday. What if she knew that, right? And the irony is the fact that we're still talking about it 15 years later. Wouldn't that be fucking brilliant? Wouldn't that be awesome?
It would be if that were true.
Yeah, I know. All my fan experiences have been wonderful, and that sounds like I would have felt weird. I would have been awesome. That's not awesome. You maybe staying in the hotel? My room's right over there. I'll roll you over.
I find that the English are the naughtiest. They are.
You get kind of like, the accent hits you, like they're profane. It's kind of like you're just very, it's like, oh yes, yes, and all of a sudden you're being, you know, fisted.
I think of the English like folk. It's like, you know, they have this veneer of like proper behavior, but underneath is this roiling, passionate thing.
Yeah.
What is it when the Vulcans, like, they're mating and they go crazy?
Bon.
Yeah, that's, they're always, the English are always on the mark.
Ponfar.
Ponfar. They're always in the ponfar.
Well, historically they were sort of the barbarians to the north.
Yeah, Saxon bastard.
Yeah.
I'm a Saxon bastard.
Me too.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm a really young watcher, and as you know, Buffy, there are a lot of allegories or life lessons, especially for a teenager. I was wondering what your favorite allegory or metaphor was to film.
Then?
I've always said, if you're making love to a 2,000-pound gorilla, it's not over until the gorilla says it's over.
You know, I don't think, for me, the writers on Buffy, every week, what they were being asked to do is to take their worst day, the day that they got humiliated, or the day that they hurt someone for no good reason, and then slap fangs on top of that and tell the world. So it was a sustained act of humiliation and bravery for the writers. I mean, truly, they were really bearing their souls to you guys constantly. And that's what I take away from it. They would never tell you the specifics. Like, they'd come down onto the set and be like,
If you realize what I just told you that I did one day, and but they would never, you know, you'd ask me, like, well, what really happened? And they'd be like,
like, if you sleep with the guy, he turns evil? Like, don't we all know that guy?
It happens with chicks, too.
And chicks with dicks, it also happens.
A Whitney Houston restaurant downtown here? No.
Hey, brother. Christy, who people mistake you for, was Summer sometimes in Dreamplay Long.
Say it again.
What was that?
Do people in real life sometimes mistake you for Miss Summers? And do you play along?
I think, what? Do people mistake her, like she's cosplaying for Buffy, for Buffy's mom?
Yeah.
And then pretends that she's not Buffy's mom, and plays along like she's cosplaying as Buffy's mom? Is that the question?
Thanks for clarifying. Could you say that again? Maybe another language? Oh yeah, this is at, thank you. He always saves me. My daughter was living in Paris for a year, and she went to a bar downtown Paris, and she met a bunch of kids who were like around 19, who were at this bar from out in the suburbs of Paris. And so, you know, they're all talking in French and getting to know one another. And he says to her, you know, this is totally random. You look so much like Buffy's mother. And she goes, yeah, she's my mom. And he goes, come on. And so she gets out, like, photographs in her iPhone to show him that I am, in fact, her mother. And he went, I knew that you have the same evil eyes. That might have gotten lost in translation.
I actually cosplayed a Spike one time. I think she's like 8 years old, and she wanted me to take her trick-or-treating. And that day, we happened to be doing Spike and Vampix. And I thought, oh, this is perfect. I'm going to go as Spike tonight. So I kept the costume. I just, like, you know, like, they released us, and I just got in the car as Spike. And we walked around the neighborhood, and all night, nobody recognized me. I just kept hearing, great Spike.
I mean, I vamped out once, but typically Xander was beaten up and bloodied a lot. Yeah. There were just times where it was probably out of just laziness, I just wanted to go home, but I would love to kind of keep on, like when I had the worst battering and bruising and bloody stuff, I would keep my makeup on and then like drive through a drive-through.
I did that one time, and I forgot, you know, because like you get tired. We were known as Buffy the Weekends. Like we would work 12 to 20 hours a day, right? So when they released you want to go home and go to bed. And I forgot to wipe the blood off my face, and I was driving home, and the cops pulled me over, and they were serious. They're like, "Who did you kill?" Tell the difference between like a wound and like as if you like got someone's carotid artery got splattered with them. They're just like, what, you know? I'm like, really? No, it's sweet. It's
this guy's a freak.
In advance to the other 364 days a year, because August 20th is the best birthday to have. We're the coolest. Uh-huh. Happy belated birthday, Mr. Carson.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. They say that Leos, that we have kind of a big ego about being Leos, but when your planet is the sun, it's hard not to be a little bit proud.
It's actually technically a big gas ball.
Nuclear reaction.
Hi, I'm Fusion. I think I speak for the majority of the room how we all were devastated when Xander left Anya at the altar. And I was just wondering if you could have changed it, or what your side of the story, what you would have wanted it to be. Would they have stayed together, or would you have kept it the way that it is?
You know, I mean, I like looking at her.
She was nice to look at, you know.
You know, I just learned, listen, I'm not, they did everything kind of perfectly. I'm not going to question Joss Whedon. Because I like looking at her. It's like, hey, Joss, you know what I mean, really? She's got nice cleavage and stuff, and I just, if we break up, I'm not going to be able to be in bed with her anymore. Stare at cleavage anymore, so you know, it's in terms of storytelling, it was the right way to go. In terms of horny Nikki, about it. Really pleased.
Hi, guys. Thanks for coming to DragonCon, by the way. So you all played your characters for a number of years, and I know a lot of actors begin to sort of take ownership of their characters. And even though you guys had the best writers that there ever have been, were there ever times when you looked at the script and said, you know, I don't think that Joyce would do this, or I don't think that Spike would have done this, or Xander?
I to this day, had the it was horrible telling Buffy to leave the house. Because that just felt so totally out of character for a mother to do that under any circumstances. And that I just wish that they had found a different way, because that just wasn't right for me.
I was often terrified by what they made me do. I realized this season, I think it was six, that I had to do to whoever they told me to do it, whenever they told me to do it, wear or not wear whatever they told me to not wear. And I got seriously terrified, and it started to become hard to come to work. It started to get hard to get out of bed. Because usually, like on a TV show, once you film the pilot, you know what you're basically going to be doing for the next 7 years, because most television shows are boring, and most television shows do the same thing over and over and over again. So, but there's a safety in that. With a film, you can read it before you sign the contract and say, okay, I can do that, or I want to do that, or I don't want to do that, I pass. But with Joss Whedon, there's no rules at all, and you have no idea what you're going to be asked to do. And artistically, I mean, in hindsight, I'm like, man, that was awesome. I'm very proud of it. In the moment, I was terrified. I was really terrified. But one of my favorite things was we would often have directors come in that had never seen the show before. And so I remember you were wounded. You were wounded over in Buffy's house, and like, everyone's crowded around you, and like, oh, Xander, are you okay? Right? And I'm over in the corner just going, like that. And the director comes up to me and goes, hey, Matt, you know, Xander is hurt, and you know him. And you're a regular, and he's a regular. You gotta go care about him. And I'm like, no, I don't care. No, Buffy's important. It's her sister, I suppose, but other than that, no.
I would not have gone into construction.
I was just wondering.
Yeah, yellow isn't in my color wheel. So that hat. Yellow hat. I would think, like, are we under construction? I'm like, fuck, I gotta put that hat on. I gotta wear wearing jeans. I gotta tuck my shirt into jeans, you know? That's against everything I believe in. That's like a child molester freaking out, but you know what I mean?
Jeans, tuck your shirt in, wear the black belt.
You know? Have a pear-shaped body. Walk like a pig with that. Getting a little personal.
I was just wondering, if y'all could choose any other character in the Buffy world, which other character would you play?
Probably the character of Fran and Kazooie.
Sit home and just collect the money.
There's no way I would play a different character.
Yeah, me neither.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Because I was an adult man, like, you know, 35, 15. right, you're dead on about when you fall in love with Spike Love, about me, then my proxy falls for the mom, and like he just cares about everything.
That was the thing. It was like, why do I care about Dawn? I mean, initially I was like, why am I taking the time? You know, that's not, I was like, oh no, that's Bo's sister. Oh yeah, of course. Take care of her,
My question is, if you guys could talk about the success of Danny Strong as a screenwriter, and did you have the same reaction watching the Emmys and going, oh my God, that's Jonathan?
You know, we did a panel yesterday with Jane Espenson, who's up here, and she was saying how the season 6-7, Danny would kind of bring her scripts to read. He's like, would you mind reading them? And so she would. She's like, yeah, you know, that one's got, you know, it's good here, it's not great there. This one's kind of got some promise. And then so finally, like, he did that a few times, and he's like, well, I wrote this other script. It's political. And Jane was like, you know, she's thinking to herself, I don't want to read any more scripts, essentially. You know, it's like, I'm done. And so she's like, okay, I'll take a reading. She's like, and it was Recap. And she's like, you've hit it out of the park, it's amazing. But she's like, you kind of pigeonholed yourself because there's only one place that would do this, and it's HBO. So you've limited your, and he's like, all right, so with HBO. it's funny, I didn't know that Jane was like reading his stuff back then. So it's kind of neat to hear that progression of it. Because I'm like, Danny Strong, he's a writer. Just kind of came out of nowhere, you know? It's nice to know that he's working on it.
Another overnight success.
Yeah. 30-year overnight success. And I don't watch the Emmys, so I didn't particularly see that moment. But I do see Danny. Because, you know, Danny, he was in the presentation. So, the one with the other Willow. So I've known Danny for a long, long, long time. But I'm super stoked for him. I think it's amazing.
Yeah.
And have you guys seen The Butler? Here? Has anybody seen The Butler? Yeah.
Yeah, he wrote it. Yeah. Like, freaking awesome. Like, 3 people have seen The Butler. Go see it. It's so good. I do. But Ghost Dog is in it, man. Yeah. And go see Ghost Dog, too. Of course, but it's one of my favorite actors. He's really one of my favorites.
Oh, man. What was it, EDME, where you played the King of Scotland?
Yeah.
Jesus.
I was going to say that also Danny Strong is writing the screenplay for the final two Mockingjay movies. So it's kind of like a DragonCon explosion of nerddom of crossover Buffy and Suzanne Collins. So it's kind of cool too.
Yeah, Danny just had like a magic to him. Like he started as, like in high school, if you need a student to say one line, it would always be Danny.
Yeah.
Like, but he was the student. Well, I don't even think that in the scripts the student had a name. It was just like, he always knocked it out of the park. And so Josh just said, yeah, we only have one other student that ever speaks in this high school. It's Danny Strong. He just kept being amazing. They just kept giving him a little more and a little more. He was fabulous. He still is, yeah.
So, I kind of have this belief that Joss Whedon was kind of that nerd in high school that we all love, and he graduated and created Google, and now everyone loves him. He's like a household name after the Avengers. So, what I want to know is if he came up to you and was like, hey, Avengers 2's coming out, who would you want to be? Any character in the Marvel Universe.
Captain America.
Mr. Freeze?
that's DC.
A Slinky's a wonderful toy. It's my favorite, my boy. I get that a lot. I typically go, because he didn't ask me. Much thought. There was a thing for a while where, like, it was an online thing where I, like, got Bruce Banner, like, the Hulk. Would have been fun to play that character. But I think Mark Ruffalo's amazing, too. Would I have been as amazing? I don't know. Probably not. No, don't worry about me. I'm doing just fine.
Hi. So, Joss Whedon, especially on Buffy, was known for making character deaths as painful as they could possibly be, like Joyce and Tara, or badass like Spikes. But Jesse was supposedly Xander and Willow's best friend, and he died, and he was just never ever mentioned again. So, what the hell was that?
Which is really odd, because I mean, Joss is typically all over that. I think Joss was upset because what he wanted to make Jesse bigger in the sense of he wanted to have what's the actor's name?
Eric
Balfour. He wanted to have Eric, like, in the titles with the series regulars, and kill him off in the second episode. And the network said, no, we have to pay him for the full season, if that's the case. So they said, no, we can't do that. But so, in fact, he wanted to always fuck with you guys from day one. And said, I'm gonna kill what you thought was a series regular in episode two. So I think maybe he was probably a little upset about that he couldn't get his way on that one, so he probably just wanted to forget about it.
This will be our last question. Good morning. So we all know Buffy was a very physically demanding show, especially for Sarah Michelle Gellar, but what was the most physically demanding episode or scene for you guys?
Wielding that axe. Friday nights at like 3 a.m. in the morning. Yeah.
I think two. I did a movie called Psycho Beach Party, and I had to suck. I know this is a funny question, but I almost drowned, so I'm going to talk about this one. We were, Lord Ambrose was playing Chicklet, and she was out there drowning, and we're in Malibu. At Point Doom in Malibu, which is a big cliff where we shot. And so she's out there, and I'm like, Chicklet, and I run in. And it's one shot, there's no coverage, because the sun's going down. And I go, and I gotta take her in, and she's acting, she's a great actress, she's acting like she's passed out. So I gotta, and then I gotta carry her out of the water, and I'm like, I'm taking it. My heart exploded. I had a cigarette before I went in the water. What am I? I'm like, I'm coming out of this, my legs are shaking, and I'm like, sexy, you know? Disgusting, horrible. I'll do that again. Anytime that we were shooting past midnight and I had two scenes off and I was awakened at 4:30 to finish my day, 4:30 in the morning was brutal. Because you're in your REM sleep, you know, it's like, you're like, please just be behind, we'll do it Monday. And you hear like, yeah. Ready for you. Like, you know, like, fuck you. I'm like, could you at least give me a 5-minute warning, you know? So that was the most painful part.
That was the one time I heard a stuntman. I only tagged a stuntman one time. Yeah, I asked him, look, it's a fight scene, it's raining, just wake me up 20 minutes before you want to shoot if I'm going straight into stunts. I'm like, no problem, but of course, I'm ready for you now. Yeah, so it's raining cats and dogs. It's supposed to be that we're on grass, but we're on cement, and it's a really thin grass. It's like this thick. So we're sliding all around. And I'm supposed to, like, the gag is that Spike kicks the guy in the nuts, but you don't really kick him in the actual nuts. You kick him in the thigh. But I missed. And then, boom! And then it just sounded like I got a pee. It's the only time that I ever yelled cut, because I really.
Like, I hate you.
Oh, he never, like, we would see each other on other projects, and we'd be doing stunts, and he'd be like, yeah, the guy had to tag me in the nuts. He never left.